So, good afternoon, one and all. So, probably this will be the last class, or one more class might be needed. So, in the last class, I have shown you the video. So, in that, we have discussed about cover test and uncover test. Today, we'll be seeing about the prism cover, Maddox rod test, and differences between concomitant and incomitant squint. Okay. So, initially, I told you cover test. Suppose one eye is deviated outside, you cover the normal eye. Then this eye will take up fixation. So cover test shows that there is some tropia and the eyeball has some good vision and it is not a paralytic squint. That's why the eyeball is again moving inside. That was about cover test. Next, similarly, uncover test. It is to detect phoria. Suppose phoria means, I told you, it is a latent squint. That means both eyes are looking straight. So when you cover one eye, the eye which has been covered, that one deviates. So once you uncover it, when you remove the cover, that eye takes up fixation. So that is uncover test, which is used to detect phoria or latent squint. Similarly, alternate cover uncover test. If you want to know whether the pathology is only present in one eye or both the eyes, then you repeat the cover and uncover test for both the eyes. That is known as alternate cover uncover test. That shows whether it is an alternating squint or a unilateral squint. Okay. So that was about the cover test and uncover test. Next, prism cover test. So this prism cover test is nothing but, you all know about this cover test. So when we put a cover, the eye deviates. So if we add a prism, that is known as a prism cover test. So basically you need to know some things about this prism cover test. Basically in cover test, what you know it is, what is the type of a squint. Suppose this eye has deviated outside and you cover this eye, this takes up fixation. So from this, what all you know it, know that it is not a paralytic squint. Vision is good in that eye and you can do from surgery and it is a heterotropia. These are the inferences from your cover test. So in your cover test, suppose one eye is deviating outside, you cover the normal eye, this abnormal eye takes up fixation. It from that the inferences are the vision is good, it is not a paralytic squint and doing surgery on that eye is useful and it is a manifest squint. These are the inferences. Now suppose you want to do surgery. So how many millimeters of the muscle you have to resect? Or how many millimeters of the muscle you have to recess? So that is a question. So for that quantification, you need prism cover test. So prism cover test is nothing but same cover test. You apply a cover and you see whether the eyeball is moving inside or not. To that, if you add a prism in front of that uncovered eye, that is known as a prism cover test. So in prism cover test, based on the power of the prism used to correct that deviation, based on that, you can know how many millimeters of muscle to resect or recess. So what is the use of prism cover test? To quantify the need, to quantify surgery. That is how many millimeters of muscle to resect and recess. That is known by this prism cover test. It is same everything just like the cover test, but extra you add a prism to know the amount of correction to be done. So basically you need to know about some points of regarding the prism, basic physics. So what does this prism do? It deviates the image to the base. Usually the prism is placed such that apex is towards the deviation. Suppose right eye is deviating outside, place the apex of the prism towards the right side. So that is the basic thing. So in prism cover test, you place the apex towards the deviation. The image deviates towards the base of the prism. And then you do the cover-uncover test or alternate cover test. So this we'll see in a diagram. So suppose there was a squint in one eye. So now what you do is, see, suppose this eye has got some squint. This eye has some esotropia, that is eyeball has rotated inside. In this particular eye, the right eye has got esotropia. That's why to know whether it is a tropia or not and whether it is a paralytic squint or not, I covered this left eye. So when I cover this left eye, this right eye is taking fixation. That is, this eyeball will move outside. So now I add prisms in front of that eye. Till a time, there is no movement in the eye. Okay, what is that we will see. So this is alternate cover test. Now in this patient's left eye is normal, right eye is abnormal. Right eye has got an esotropia, that is inward deviation of the eyeball. Now what you do is you have to perform alternate cover test. So first, as per the cover test rules, what we do is we cover this normal eye. So when you cover this normal eye, what happens is this eye takes a fixation, that is it becomes straight. Now what you do is you put a prism. When you put a prism, what happens is the eye doesn't move. That is how wide the eye doesn't move, that I will tell you in the next slide. So in that way, you perform the cover test on both the eyes and you see the point where the movement stops. And that is the point or the power of the prism based on which you decide how many millimeters of resection or recession is to be done. So what is the principle is, the prism cover test is, it makes the image fall on the fovea of the deviating eye so that movement of fixation ceases. So what is this? We will see. See that same diagram I gave you in that photograph, I gave you in a diagrammatic way. So suppose this right eye is normal. So the ray of light is straightly falling on the fovea centralis, everything is normal. So here this is also a normal left eye. Actually, the rays from this fovea, rays of this ray of light from this object should come and fall exactly on the fovea centralis. Now what I did is I took a prism. So I took a prism and kept it in this pattern. So a prism, what it does is, any ray of light passing through a prism, the rays of light get deviated towards the base of the prism. Okay. So the principle of prism is, any ray of light passing through a prism, the ray of light gets deviated towards the base of the prism. Okay, that is what happens actually in a prism, when you place a prism in front of the eye. Now there is a patient whose right eye and left eye both are normal here. Now the ray of light coming from an object is falling exactly on the fovea in the right eye. In the left eye also, the rays of light coming from outside should fall exactly on the fovea, this dotted line. But now what I did is, just for a change, I took a prism and I kept the prism in front of this normal eye. Now what does this prism do is, actually the light should travel along this blue dotted lines. This is the path of the light. Light from this object should travel along this blue dotted lines and should come and fall on the fovea. But now what I did is, I kept a prism in its place. What does this prism do is, it deviates the rays of light coming into the prism towards the base of the prism. So this is the base of the prism, and this pointed one is the apex of the prism, that is the apex of the triangle. So a prism's property is that it deviates the rays of light towards the base of the prism. So when I kept a prism, what happened is, the light, instead of coming along this blue dotted lines, this ray of light got deviated and it came and fell here somewhere. So now what the eye does it, it automatically, eye wants a clear rays of light. Okay, so when you want to have a good vision, the rays of light should fall exactly on the fovea. What I told you in the first class is, fovea is the place where we have the maximum visual acuity. So if you want to have a clear image of an object, the light ray should be falling on the fovea. But here, because of this prism, the light rays are falling away from the fovea. So to compensate for this, what the eyeball does is, the eyeball rotates. So this is the direction of the rotation of the eyeball. It rotates in such a manner that this fovea comes exactly to this point where this light rays are falling. So you see in this diagram, so when I kept a prism, the rays of light are falling somewhere else beside the fovea, and to get a clear vision, the rays of light should fall on the fovea. That's why, to compensate for that, to get a clear image, what happens is, this eyeball turns or rotates in such a way that in this direction it rotates, such that this fovea comes exactly to the place or the point where this rays of light are falling. So this is the principle of prism cover test. So when you put a prism, the eyeball starts moving. Okay. Now what happens is, suppose I increase the power of this prism. Now this is a small, this is some prism, some higher power, which causes a deviation up to this much of extent. Suppose you think this is a prism of power of 1 prism diopter. Now I take a power of 3 prism diopter. So what does it do? That 3 prism diopter makes the rays of light fall somewhere in between the object and the fovea. So what happens when the next image is falling somewhere here, then what happens is, the eyeball, instead of deviating the whole extent, it deviates only to half part, that is up to here. Okay. Now I'll further increase the power of the prism. Suppose I will take a prism of 5 diopters power. So when I take a prism of 5 diopters, what it does is, the light rays, instead of falling here, they'll straightly fall on the fovea. So then there will be no more movement of the eyeball. So that is the power of the prism, which is utilizing the squint in that particular patient. So again, coming back again. So let me be clear once again. Rays of light should actually fall on the fovea. Here also, the rays of light should actually travel along these blue dotted lines and they should fall on the fovea. But simply what I did is, I kept a prism in the path of the light. So what does this prism do is, it deviates the rays of light falling on the prism towards the base of the prism. This is the base of the prism. So towards the base, the light deviates. So to get a clear vision, the fovea should be exactly corresponding to that part where this exact light rays are falling, that is this green rays. So to compensate for that, the eyeball rotates in this direction till the fovea comes onto this green line. That is what naturally happens. Now what I do is, when I use a prism of power 1 diopter, the rays are falling somewhere here and the eyeball is rotating. Suppose you think this is a squinting eye. Suppose this eye truly has a squint, or this normal eye only we take. Rays of light are falling here for a prism of power 1 prism diopter. Now I increase the power of the prism. I take a prism of 3 prism diopters. Then what happens is, this rays of light do not fall here. but they fall somewhere here in between the object and the fovea. Then what happens, the eyeball, instead of moving from this F to O point, it rotates only up to some point somewhere in the middle of F and O. Now what I do is I further increase the strength of my prism. Suppose I take a prism of 5 prism diopters power. Now that prism, what it does is it makes the rays of light straightly fall on the fovea. So they're exactly along this blue line, the rays of light will come and fall. Then what will happen is there will be no more movement of the eyeball. So because the vision is clear. So this is the same principle we apply. So here there is some deviation. We are covering this eye. We are making rays of light fall somewhere on the eyeball. It is not exactly falling on the fovea. So the eyeball rotates. This squinting eye rotates till it takes a fixation, till the rays of light are exactly falling on the fovea. Now what I do is, when the eyeball rotates till the rays vision is clear, that is the rays of light fall on the fovea. Now what I do, I increase the power of this prism. When I increase the power of this prism, still the eyeball is moving so that the rays of light are falling on the fovea. Now I further increase the power to up almost for 5 prism diopters, for example. If I take a prism of 5 prism diopters, what it does is, it makes the rays of light exactly fall on the fovea of this deviating eye. Then what will happen as, because of the prism, the rays of light are directly falling on the fovea, the eyeball will not deviate anymore. The eyeball will remain in the same position. So that is the part where it is known as point of neutralization. So that is the point, that is the exact power of the prism, which makes the rays of light directly fall on the fovea, so that there is no more any movement of the eyeball in the squinting eye. So that is the exact power of the prism, what we take into account. So that is the power. So for based on the prism diopter, we decide. Suppose there is a 1 prism diopter of deviation, 2 millimeter of resection. Suppose 2 prism diopters, some 4 millimeters of resection of the muscle. So that's what. To quantify, we do this prism cover test. So it makes the image fall on the fovea of the deviating eye. So that on the deviating eye's fovea, the image is falling. So when the image is falling on the fovea, the eyeball will not move, so that it won't take a fixation. Here, because the image is falling somewhere here, the eyeball is rotating. But when I take a prism of higher power, which will make the rays of light fall exactly on the fovea, then there will not be any more movement of the eyeball. So that is the neutralizing prism. That is the power of the prism which is causing neutralization. So for that prism, based on the power of the prism, we decide how much to obey. If it is a 1 prism diopter, we do 2 mm of resection. The tables will be available. So based on that, we decide. Suppose 5 prism diopters is required to neutralize. So 5 into 2, roughly 10 millimeters will resect the muscle or recess the muscle. That one information we'll get from some tables. So that is the use of this prism cover test. Hope you are all clear with this. Okay. So the same thing applies here. So you see the light reflex. You can see till the here two aspects are that you do the prism cover test in two things. One is either till there is no movement of the eyeball or till this light reflex is falling exactly on the center. What is that light reflex? We'll see in a later test. So that is about the prism cover test. Next one is the Maddox rod test. This one they might be asking you in your exams. In your Viva, they'll be showing you a Maddox rod. What is that, they will ask. It is basically a dissociative test. It has a red line and a white dot which should intersect. So what is this? So you see, this is a Maddox rod. So Maddox rod is something red in color. In exam, they'll be asking you. So in exam, they give you this sort of a lens. Along with this lens, they give you. So this is a Maddox rod. This is the frame. This black one is the frame. So this Maddox rod is nothing but cylindrical lenses. These are red colored. A red color. You can see here it is all red. Red colored cylindrical lenses which are stacked parallel to one another. So this is one cylindrical lens, this is one cylindrical lens, this is one cylindrical lens. So all these are cylindrical lenses which are stacked together with their axis parallel to each other. So this is known as Maddox rod. It is actually not, it is called a rod because there are cylinders are used, cylindrical lenses are used. Cylindrical lenses appear in shape of a rod. So multiple cylindrical lenses are placed parallel to one another, which are red in painted red in color. So this is a Maddox rod. So what is the function? So this is how you test, do a test with a Maddox rod. So when you put a Maddox rod in front of one eye and you leave the other eye like this and you show him a torch light. Suppose you focus a torch light onto the patient or else you ask him to see a light. Then what happens is when you put a Maddox rod in front of the eye, the image appearing through this Maddox rod appears as a straight line perpendicular to these rods. So here suppose you see these rods are vertically oriented. You can see these stripes. These are vertically placed here, these stripes. Now when you show a point source of light like a torch light to this Maddox rod, what happens is as the cylindrical lens allow refraction only in one plane, it will be dealt with in refractive errors class. Then we can know about it clearly. So here what happens is the rays of light fall perpendicular to this one. So how it appears is you see like this. See. So when the patient is seeing straight, actually, if there is a normal patient, the patient is not having any squint. So when you place this Maddox rod in front of one eye and you leave the other eye open without putting anything, so these Maddox rod cylinders are placed in this angle, horizontally they are placed here. So when these cylinders are placed horizontally, the patient sees a red line. So when the Maddox rod is placed horizontally in front of one eye of the patient and you show him a bright torch light, a point source of light, it appears as a vertical line. So the patient, what he sees is, in the straight gaze, through this right eye, the patient sees a red line which is erect, and to the left eye, the patient sees the point source of light or that white dot. Okay, that is what the patient sees. So a normal patient, when he's looking towards the right also, to the right eye, he will see a straight vertical right red color line, and to the left eye, he will see only one point source of light or torch light. Similarly, in the left gaze also, when the patient is looking to the left, if he is a normal patient and not having any squint, he will see one vertical red line in front of the right eye and a left a dot or a white colored point source of light in front of the left eye. And as there is no diplopia here, because both eyes are looking straight, they will be overlapping on one another. As there is no squint, the patient is normal, and there is binocular single vision. I told you in first classes, in binocular single vision, the images of both the eyes are fused to one particular object by the brain. So it is fused as a one particular object, just like your lion and cage in simultaneous perception, fused in stereopsis, three grades of binocular single vision. Similar to simultaneous perception, that lion and cage example, if you take, suppose this right eye is seeing a lion. For example, that line is nothing but this vertical straight line here, and this left eye is seeing a cage. Cage is nothing but this round colored shape of this light. Both are superimposed on one another. So this is what happens in a normal patient, that is Maddox rod. Okay, so when the patient has no squint in orthophoria, it will be looking like this. So when there is an esophoria, the rod will be towards one side and the point source of light will be towards the other side. In exophoria also, it is the same. In hyperphoria, it will be above and below. In hypophoria also same. So these are most of the details are not necessary for you. Just to remember that in case of orthophoria, the eye in front of which the Maddox rod has been placed, it sees a red vertical line. And the other eye, which is bare, which is not having any Maddox rod, that will only see a point source of light. Both of them overlap in case of orthophoria. In case of squint, they fall one beside the other. If it is a horizontal deviation like esophoria and exophoria, they fall one beside the other. If it is a hyperphoria or hypophoria, vertical squints, then what happens is they fall above and below. Up to that much you remember, it is enough. Okay. Next, Maddox wing test. Maddox wing test is nothing but it is an instrument. So here you can see it is a goggles-like thing. This one is placed on the nose bridge. This bridge you can see here. So this is placed on the nose of the patient. So through the right eye, the patient will be seeing these arrows. Through the left eye, the patient will be seeing these numbers. So through the right eye, the patient will be seeing this red arrow and white arrow. Through the left eye, the patient will be seeing this white numbers and the red numbers. Now what you say is, if there is a normal person will see that the red eye is, this red arrow is exactly corresponding to the zero on this red one. Similarly, this through the left eye, he will see that this white arrow is exactly corresponding to this zero point. Okay. So any normal person, Maddox wing test, we place these goggles in front of the patient. The patient from the right eye, he will be seeing that this red arrow where it is falling on the number scale. And from the left eye, he will be seeing the white arrow where it is falling. So based on that, he will tell. Suppose for a normal person, the red arrow should be at zero and the white arrow should be at zero. For any squint, based on the type, which eye is deviating, it will be either esophoria or exophoria. Here you see, if towards this 22 side, if it positive side is exophoria, negative side is esophoria. Similarly, this upper side is hyperphoria, lower side is hypophoria. It will all be marked on the instrument here. It is not so clear here. So this is all required for PG level, not for you. Just remember that in Maddox wing, the patient from right eye sees a red arrow and you will see on which number it is falling. From left eye, you will see this white arrow on which number it is falling. Suppose both are falling on zero, no problem, the patient is normal, is not having any squint. Suppose this red arrow is falling somewhere above or somewhere below, that means patient is having some squint. Similarly, if the white arrow is falling somewhere over this side or that side, is having some squint. That much you remember, it is enough. Don't go into depth, it will be very confusing. Okay. Next, what is the treatment for squint? Basically, refractive error correction. Basically, I told you in the first class, spectacle correction itself can solve the problem of squint. Only if you give spectacles itself, that is enough. Second thing is orthoptic treatment. Suppose you think there is a paralytic squint, lateral rectus muscle is having some palsy. Suppose there is a hemiplegia patient, cerebrovascular accident, there is some hemiplegia and there is weakness of this upper limb. So what you do, you tell him some physiotherapy, you ask him to do exercise, do some dumbbells or something, so that his muscles will regain power. Similarly, for eyeballs also, we have got some exercise like called as orthoptic exercises. In that, what we do is, suppose medial rectus palsy is there, we ask him to take a pencil and to sharp the pencil to the pointed tip so that the tip is very pointed. Put the pencil at a far distance and bring the pencil close towards your eye and look towards the pencil. So what, and stay, put the pencil like that for 10 seconds and try to look at the pointed tip of the pencil for 10 seconds. Then what will happen, both your eyes will converge and the power of your medial rectus muscle will improve. So this is one example of an orthoptic exercise. So similarly, you can ask him to look this side or look that side. That is one thing. And prescription of prisms in glasses. So what is the main problem with squint is you have diplopia, because I told you in the previous diagrams, I've explained you, one eye will be deviating, the image will be falling on the non-corresponding point of the retina, which will cause a false localization because it x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis points are different. So the image will be appearing to be present somewhere else. Suppose the main image is in front, the false image will be somewhere towards the right or towards the left, which is called diplopia, double vision. So prism, what it is doing is it is causing the eyeball to rotate. It is making the rays of light to fall on the fovea. If the rays of light in both eyes are falling on the fovea, then there will no more be any diplopia. That's why the prisms I told you in that example. So if you put a prism in front of the glass, what will happen is the rays of light won't fall on the extra foveal point. So there won't be any diplopia. The rays of light will fall exactly on the fovea, thereby reducing diplopia. So that is one more treatment for prisms. So if this refractory correction, muscular orthoptic treatment and prisms, all these fail, then we go for surgery for the squint. Okay. Now there are two types of squints, basically concomitant and incomitant. This is very important for you. In exam, they'll be asking you the differences between concomitant and incomitant squint. So what is concomitant? Concomitant means it is a manifest squint, that is tropia. It is a tropia, heterotropia. It could be exotropia, esotropia, hypertropia, or hypotropia, anything it can be. So concomitant squint, it is a manifest squint. That is the first point. Manifest squint means as soon as you see the patient's face, you can say that he's having squint because one eye will be deviating towards one particular side. So when you see a patient, if the eyeball is deviating to some other side, then you can say that it is a manifest squint. Okay. So that manifest squint can be concomitant or incomitant. So how will you know whether it is a concomitant squint or incomitant squint? If the deviation between the two eyes is same in all directions, it is known as a concomitant squint. What is that? We'll see in a diagram. Okay. So what is the etiology for this? The etiology is unclear. Most of the concomitant squints are idiopathic. Probably I told you the critical period of development of vision, it is from the birth to 6 years of life, or precisely to say from 6 months of life to 6 years of life. So that is the critical period of vision. So any cataract or any corneal opacity or any ptosis which might have caused interruption of vision during this critical period, that is 6 months to 6 years, that can lead to some extraocular muscle imbalance and it can lead to any squint. So the etiology is still unclear. It is under research. So it is a manifest squint. That is, on seeing the patient itself, you can say that he's having some squint. And the deviation is same in all the directions. So what is that we will see? It could be unilateral or alternating ocular deviation. In that cover and cover test video I showed you, initially when we did the cover test, only one eye was deviating. But later on when we saw, both eyes were deviating. So one eye could be deviating and other eye also could be deviating. This eye will take up fixation for some time and the other eye will take fixation for some time. So concomitant squint can be unilateral. Only one eye can be affected, or it could be alternating. That is, both eyes it can alternate. That is number one point. It could be esotropia, inward deviation, exotropia, outward deviation, hypertropia, upward deviation. Okay, hypotropia is downward deviation. Here primary deviation is equal to secondary deviation. What is that we will see. And ocular deviation is same in all gazes. There is no restriction of extraocular movements. Here you have to see all the extraocular movements are full. I told you there are ductions and versions in my first class. Ductions are uniocular movements and versions are binocular movements. So there is no restriction of any extraocular movements in case of a concomitant squint, because here there is no paralysis of the muscle. Basically, concomitant means it is not a paralysis. There is only some imbalance between the muscular innervation. So here the lat, suppose you take the example of lateral rectus muscle. So when you check what happens is eyeball is deviating somewhere outside, but when you see the unilateral ductions, when you see the one eye, you touch the movements, that eye is completely deviating towards the outside. That means there is no paralysis and there is no restriction of extraocular movements. Okay. So there could be suppression. I told you suppression. When there is a diplopia, automatically one eye is suppressed by the brain. So based on the suppression, it could be monocular or alternating squint, and it can also lead to amblyopia. If constantly that eye is suppressed, even after that you do squint surgery also, after the age of 12 years, if you do surgery also, there will be no use, because the eye has already gone into suppression and it has prolonged suppression eye, it goes into amblyopia or lazy eye. Okay. So types of concomitant squint are convergent, divergent and vertical. Okay. So now what is the deviations? This primary deviation and secondary deviation is, so here basically Okay. Basically, here the prism you have taken, this prism cover test. So suppose this prism you kept in front of the normal eye and you see till when the neutralization is coming. So when you place the prism in front of the normal eye and you measure the deviation, it is known as primary deviation. Suppose my right eye has got a squint and left eye is looking straight. Suppose on this normal eye, on this left eye, I keep my prism and see that this muscle is coming into neutralization. So then it is called primary deviation. So primary deviation is, suppose there is a squint. When there is a squint, you do prism bar cover test. So based on prism bar cover test only, you say how many diopters. So here I told you the example. For one prism diopter, there is this much of movement. For three prism diopters, the image will fall somewhere here and the movement will be reduced. When I put a prism of five prism diopters, the image will fall exactly on the fovea and there will not be any movement. So here, how much is the squint? If anyone asks you, you should say that there is five prism diopters of squint. So that is my primary deviation. So when you place this prism in front of the normal eye, suppose this right eye is having a squint. I put a prism in front of the left eye, in front of the left eye, that is a normal eye, and I see that this right eye is taking up fixation. So that is known as primary deviation. So how much power of prism, if I keep in front of the normal eye, the movement in this left eye stops, that is known as primary deviation. Suppose you put the prism on the abnormal eye. Suppose on this eye you will put the prism and you will see the time you will see for how much prism diopters this eye is moving or this normal eye is moving. That is known as secondary deviation. So primary deviation and secondary deviation are nothing but same prism bar cover test. This prism cover test, if you place in front of the normal eye, that is known as primary deviation. Suppose for primary deviation, you get five prism diopters. So if you put this prism in front of the deviating abnormal eye and you see till how much time the movement is taking place in the normal eye, so that is known as secondary deviation. So in concomitant squint, as it is not paralytic, there is no paralysis of the muscle, primary deviation is equal to secondary deviation. Why? Because your all muscles are intact, all muscles have got the full power. That's why your primary deviation is equal to secondary deviation. In case of paralysis, what happens? Suppose there is a paralysis in this right eye of mine. Suppose you think there is a paralytic squint in the right eye. Then what happens is more amount of power, more amount of neurological innervation is required for this muscle to act. Suppose my right lateral rectus muscle is paralyzed. So when the muscle is paralyzed, suppose it is not totally plegic. There is a term called paresis and plegia. Paresis means partial weakness of the muscle. Plegia means complete paralysis of the muscle. If it is a plegia, we can't do anything. It is totally out of scope. Suppose it is a paresis. There is only weakness of the muscle and it is not completely paralytic. Then what happens is if you increase the innervation towards that weakened muscle, there is chance that it will take a fixation. So similarly, when you place a secondary deviation, if you put in front of the abnormal eye, already there is some paralysis. When there is paralysis, you need a prism of higher power to bring about the point of neutralization. Whereas if it is a concomitant squint, when there is no paralysis, even for the same power of the prism for which the right eye got neutralized, for the same power, this left eye will also get neutralized. Because the muscles are active here, there is no paresis or no weakness of the muscles. As there is no weakness of the muscles, what happens is the same power of the prism which you get in the normal eye, the same power you will get in the abnormal eye also. So the primary deviation is equal to secondary deviation in case of a concomitant squint. But in case of a paralytic squint, when there is a weakness of the muscle, there is some extra innervation is required from the brain to that weakened muscle so as to make the eye straight. So what happens is we need a higher power of the prism. Unless you put a higher power and we make it fall exactly on the fovea or even sometimes opposite towards the direction of the fovea, only till the eye will not stop moving. So secondary deviation will obviously be more than primary deviation in case of a incompetent squint. Okay. So ocular deviation is same in all the gazes. So in all the gazes, I mean that when you are looking straight, my left eye, right eye has got a squint. Right eye is like this and left eye is like this. The angle between both these is, suppose some 60 degrees you think. Between my right eye and left eye, the angle is 60 degrees. So in case of concomitant squint, what happens is, when you look in the primary gaze also, the angle will be 60 degrees. When you look towards the right gaze also, the angle will be 60. When you look towards the left gaze also, the angle will be 60. Similarly, when you do dextro elevation also, the angle will be same. Levo elevation also, the angle will be same. Levo depression also, the angle will be same. So the angle, this particular angle between the right eye and the left eye, the abnormal eye and the normal eye will be the same in all the gazes in case of a concomitant squint. But suppose it is a paralytic squint. In a paralytic squint, suppose there is a lateral rectus palsy of this right eye. Then what happens is, When you're looking straight, both eyeballs will be normal because the medial rectus will be acting. When you look this side, both the deviation will be, it will be same angle. Both the lines, eyes will be parallel to one another. But sir, this right lateral rectus muscle is paralyzed. So when you look towards this side, right side, what happens is, as this side lateral rectus is paralyzed, this eye will not deviate. It will be remaining straight. But this left eye will move like this. So what happens is, the angle between these two, it is changing. So that is the this one. So in case of a concomitant squint, when there is no paralysis, the angle between the both the eyes is same in case of all the gazes. But suppose it is a paralytic squint, the right side eyeball has got a right lateral rectus muscle palsy. When you look straight, the angle between both these is normal. When you look towards the left gaze, it is normal. But when you want to look towards the right side, this right side lateral rectus muscle is paralyzed. So this eye won't go towards the lateral side. It will remain straight. But his left eye will be deviating inside. So what happens is, the angle between both the eyes will reduce. So that is what known as the ocular deviation will be same in all the gazes in case of a concomitant squint, and it will be different in different gazes in a paralytic squint. Primary deviation is equal to secondary deviation in case of a concomitant squint. When you put the prism in front of the normal eye and you measure, it is called primary deviation. When you put the prism in front of the abnormal eye or squinting eye and you measure the deviation, it is called secondary deviation. In terms of prism diopters, in case of a concomitant squint, both will be the same. For example, if primary deviation is 5 prism diopters, secondary will also be 5 prism diopters. But in case of incompetent squint, what happens is, if the primary deviation is 5 prism diopters, the secondary deviation will be more than that. It will be around 10 or 20 prism diopters, depending on the degree of weakness of the muscle. And there won't be any restriction of extraocular movements. I told you, if this right lateral rectus muscle is paralyzed, it won't be moving right side. So its movement is restricted. But in case of concomitant squint, it won't happen so. Everything will be rotating towards this side or that side. So that is about the concomitant squint. Okay. And suppression and amblyopia can be seen in case of a concomitant squint. In paralytic squint, it is not there. Okay. Now, what are the types of concomitant squint? So that is the basic thing. From here on, everything is easy. So types of concomitant squint, it would be convergent, both moving here, divergent, or it could be vertical, one looking up and one looking down. So convergent squint can be esotropia, inward deviation of one eye. It can be unilateral, one eye can be affected, or both eyes alternating. So see, this is an example of esotropia. Here both eyes are deviating inside. So this is an example of esotropia or manifest squint. This is also, see, here esotropia is there in both the eyes. You can see both the eyes are deviating inside. But here you see esotropia is there only in this one eye. This eye is looking straight. Here you see the light what I'm showing is falling exactly on the center of the pupil, but here it is not falling on the center. So here only one eye is having esotropia, other eye is normal. And now here only the deviation is same in this primary gaze. Is this one. So if the patient looks towards the right or patient looks towards the light or left also, the deviation will be same in between both the eyes. So what are the types of esotropia? It could be accommodative or non-accommodative or secondary or consecutive. So what is this accommodative esotropia? Accommodative means, I told you, suppose you're looking at a far object and when you want to look at a near object, both eyeballs tend to converge. That is known as accommodation. So when this accommodation is in excess, suppose there is excess of convergence of both the eyes, then it can lead to esotropia. So when you are looking at a near object, automatically there will be some physiological esotropia. That is accommodative. So anything which is not accommodative is non-accommodative. Or it could be secondary. Secondary because of some tumors or due to, suppose there is some pontine hemorrhage or some other cause. Or it could be consecutive. Consecutive means post-surgery. Suppose there is an esotropia. What I did is, I did surgery on the patient. With that surgery, what I did is, I did excess of surgery. So instead of the eye becoming straight, it went outside. So that is consecutive esotropia. Consecutive esotropia means, you remember, consecutive means it is secondary to a surgery. Suppose already there is an exotropia in a patient, for that patient I did surgery. After surgery, what should happen is eyeball should become straight. But if I cut some excess of muscle, I did surgery. Some extra muscle also I cut during my surgery. Then what will happen is, it will become esotropia. So there is an exotropia. When I did surgery, it should come straight. I did some excess of surgery. As a result of that, the eyeball turned inside instead of remaining straight. Exotropia should become straight. Instead of that, it turned inside. That is consecutive esotropia. Secondary esotropia is because of some causes. Like suppose there is an injury. Suppose there is a road traffic accident. There is some injury to this muscle. Medial rectus muscle injuries or lateral rectus muscle injuries there. So it causes secondary types of esotropia. So accommodative esotropia, I told you, overaction of convergence. When you look at the near object, when there is more, it is secondary. It is usually seen in, it is usually refractive type, 2 to 3 years of age. In that age, it is more, because in those people, almost up to 15 diopters of accommodation will be there. By the age of 4 years, it will be only 3 diopters. So high hypermetropes, it is more, because in hypermetropia, they tend to use accommodation more in order to get a clear image. So in these cases, accommodation will be more, and it is more for near. Obviously, when you are looking at a near object, you will definitely use more accommodation. That's why obviously it will be more. So it could be refractive error. Because of refractive error, it could be present accommodation, or it could be of non-refractive. Non-refractive means high accommodation by high AC by A ratio. AC is accommodative convergence by accommodation. This is a little difficult to understand. Just to remember, high AC by A ratio. It is nothing but accommodation actually means increase in the anterior curvature of lens. The anterior surface of the lens is there, no? So the anterior surface of lens curvature will increase. Suppose it is normally flat. If you want to normal power of lenses, some 15 to 18 diopters. In accommodation, it should have some extra 3 to 4 diopters. So what it does is it increases the curvature. When the curvature of the lens will increase, so normally there is a flat lens, it has some 15 diopters of power. When its curvature increases, it becomes more convex and the power goes to 18 to 20 diopters. So this is what normally happens. So this lens curvature increase is determined based on the tone of the ciliary muscle. So for this much of, suppose for some 1% of contraction of ciliary muscle, there should be some 1% convergence. Actually, based on the rule, for the 1% of contraction of the ciliary muscle, which increases, suppose the ciliary muscle is holding like this, when the ciliary, suppose it is like this, the lens is like this, the ciliary muscles are holding. So when the ciliary muscles contract, this eyeballs, this lens anterior surface curvature increases. So if the ciliary muscle will contract by 1%, accommodation, this lens curvature will increase by 1 diopter, and your convergence of both eyeballs should increase by 1%. Instead of that, suppose the ciliary muscle is contracting only by 1%, but your convergence is becoming more because of some problems in the cerebral hemisphere due to some neurological problems or CNS manifestations, then we call high AC by A ratio. So the convergence is more compared to the accommodation. So then you get non-refractive type of accommodative esotropia, or it could be a mixture of two. That is one thing. Okay. So non-accommodative, it can be again essential infantile esotropia. It is present at birth or 6 months from birth, or late onset esotropia. Late onset is occurs after 6 months. It is again basic type, convergence excess, divergence insufficiency. All this I told you in my first classes. Basic type means at distance as well as near, the deviation will be same. In convergence excess, for that near, it will be more. For divergence insufficiency, when you look far, the lateral rectus muscles are weak. As a result, the eyeballs, instead of deviating outside or remaining straight, because the lateral rectus muscle is weak, they tend to converge inside. That is divergence insufficiency. All these I told you in my previous classes. Okay. And what is secondary esotropia? Secondary esotropia, it could be due to monocular lesions. I told you, suppose there is some trauma. Post-trauma, there could be some esotropia because of some hematoma. Suppose post-trauma, there is some hematoma here and there is some this one. Or there could be resting position of eyeball. There is a concept called resting position of eyeball. If your eye is totally blind for some days, suppose your eye is totally blind for some days and it is not seeing. After some days, what will happen is the eye will not remain in a straight gaze. It will take a position of rest. Because to maintain the eyeballs in the straight orthophoria, all the six extraocular muscles should be working. Unless all the six extraocular muscles are working, there will not be, eyeballs won't be maintained in a straight gaze. So suppose when there is a blindness in that particular eye, there is no visual impulse, there will not be any feedback to the extraocular muscle. So extraocular muscle will not be maintaining the eyeball in a straight gaze. So what happens is it goes into resting position of eyeball. Suppose there is some injury to the eye and the eyeball eye became completely blind in his childhood. Then what will happen is the eye will take a position known as resting position. In resting position of eyeball, what will happen is if the trauma has occurred, it will go into esotropia. In adults, if it will happen, it will go into exotropia. Okay. So in general anesthesia, suppose you give, the patient is unconscious or comatose or dead patient, the eyeball will go into exotropia. So ESO in children, exo in adults. There is a concept called resting position of eyeball. What is this resting position is? Suppose there is a monocular lesion. Suppose the eye is totally blind. When the eye is totally blind, the eyeball will not be maintaining in a straight gaze because that is an active process and it needs a feedback. Unless your visual impulses are going, unless those impulses are processed by the brain and feedback is given to the extraocular muscles, your eye won't be remaining straight. That is the thing. So now what happens is when the vision is totally gone in this eye, it takes a position called resting position. That resting position is either it could be ESO deviation or exo deviation. If the eye is blind, in childhood, it goes into esotropia. If the eye becomes blind after becoming adults, the eyeball goes into exo deviation. Exo deviation is more common than the ESO deviation. If you give deep general anesthesia, when the patient is out of his consciousness also, eye will go deviate outside exotropia. Similarly, why exo deviation is more common? Because the orbit's axis, you see, the lateral walls of the orbits are completely divergent and the medial walls are parallel to one another. That's why, based on the axis of the orbit also, the eyeball deviates outside exo. That is one important concept. So consecutive, I told you, surgical overcorrection of exotropia. There is an exotropia, you do surgical correction, it should come straight. I do axis of surgery, it will come instead. That is consecutive esotropia. Okay. So next, similarly, divergence squint. Outward deviation of one eye while the other eyeball fixates. So outward deviation is known as a divergence squint or exotropia. So see, this eye is looking straight, this eye is looking outside. This is a divergence squint. So types of exotropia, congenital is usually rare. Congenital esotropia is more common than exotropia. The reason because of this is, in children, what I told you, accommodation is very much more. In children, the accommodation, the near object, looking at a near object is almost 15 to 18 prism diopters. Almost 15 to 18 diopters of accommodation, not prism diopters, only diopters. In children, the accommodation is of higher range, on the higher side. Almost 15 to 18 diopters of accommodation is present in children. In adult age, by the age of 40, we have only 3 diopters of accommodation. By the age of 60, our accommodation will become zero. So in children, as the accommodation is more, esotropia is more common in children compared to exotropia. That is one PG bit they might be asking you. So in children, usually what kind of a squint is more common? Is it esotropia or is it exotropia? You can say it is esotropia. Why? Because in children, as the accommodation is more powerful, eso deviations are more common compared to exo deviations. So congenital exotropia is, that's why, very rare. This one we are talking about exotropia. It could be primary, that is, reason is unknown, we don't know, idiopathic. Secondary because I told you resting position of eyeball, I told you previously. Or it could be consecutive, surgical overcorrection of esotropia. Suppose there's an esotropia, I did a surgery. After surgery, the eye should become straight. Instead of that, the eye is deviating outside. So that is a consecutive exotropia. Okay. So primary exotropia, it can be present in one eye or alternating both eyes. It can be intermittent or constant. So totally it might be present, or it can be present intermittently only and during sometimes. That is when the patient gets some fever, or patient is totally tired, or is having some fatigue, or is malnourished or undernourished. At that time, we can have a squint. Intermittent is most common compared to constant type. Age, it is seen in 2 to 5 years of age. Usually there is no amblyopia and good fusion is present. In intermittent type, because only occasionally the eye is deviating, most of the times the eye is remaining straight. There won't be any amblyopia and good fusion will be there. Constant type, so untreated intermittent. Suppose this intermittent is left untreated, it will go into constant type. Suppose the eye is occasionally deviating, if you do some surgery, it is becoming straight. So there is no problem. Suppose the eye is completely, the intermittent type, the duration of intermittency is increasing. Suppose initially per day, only for 1 hour, the eyeball is deviating outside, rest of the time it is constant. There is no problem. But suppose that intermittent type is progressing, whole day the eye is remaining in exotropia, it will gradually go into constant type. So untreated intermittent exotropia usually becomes this constant type of exotropia. Okay. So primary exotropia types, convergence insufficiency, I told you. So when you see at a near object, both your medial rectus should muscle and eye should converge. Suppose there is a medial rectus weakness, there is an insufficiency of the convergence, then eye will look straight or eye will look outside. That is convergence insufficiency. So divergence excess, when you are looking at a far object, your lateral rectus muscles overact and there is a divergence. And basic type or non-specific type, the deviation is same for both near and distance. Similarly, test for concomitant squint, the same things again, visual acuity and refraction, extraocular movements you will see. You will see the anterior segment, any cataract is there, ptosis is there, or corneal opacity is there, because that could be a cause of squint here. Or you could see there is any posterior segment pathology, for example, any retinal tumor, or in that fovea, you're having any hemangiomas, etc. And you can see these pupil reactions can, because there is some optic atrophy. Suppose there is a patient is having a glaucoma. Because of glaucoma, the eye went into optic atrophy and it became blind. So that is the cause for this resting position of eyeball or secondary squint. That's why if you see pupil reactions, you can know. The pupil reactions is a long class, we'll see in neuro-ophthalmology. So when the pupil reactions are not correct, so in optic atrophy, you'll have a relative apparent pupillary defect. So that produces a clue that it could be a secondary type of a squint. So what are the other tests? Works for dotish, Bagolnis, Maddox rod, Maddox swing. Maddox rod, I already told you. Maddox swing, I told you. Double Maddox rod test is, you put 2 Maddox rod on both eyes. Instead of seeing one vertical line and dot, in case of double Maddox rod, what will happen is you will see 2 lines. So one on one eye will put it horizontally, one eye will put vertically. So on one eye, you will see a vertical line, and other eye, you will see a horizontal line. And we can based on that. And synoptophore, fixation with ophthalmoscope, Pickman's fly test, all these are not necessary for you. Just remember this Maddox rod test, which they'll ask you in exam. And works for dotish.